Hey, what's going on, guys? Welcome back to another video. So in this video, we will learn about concepts like what is monolithic application, how they are built and deployed, and what are the pros and cons of using it. We will see how microservices architecture solves the problem and what are the different solutions available to communicate between the microservices with their pros and cons. So there's a lot of things to learn in this video. So if this sounds interesting, then stick around. Also, don't forget to subscribe the channel and press the bell icon so that you don't miss the videos like this one. So let's get started. Alright guys, so today's video is sponsored by Zego Cloud. Zego Cloud is a global cloud communication service provider, which provides developer-friendly and powerful SDK and API to build many communication features on the app, such as video call, chat, video conference, live streaming, and many more. Zego Cloud is trusted by more than 4,000 businesses and offers pre-built UI kits and SDKs to developer and businesses. Recently, they have introduced their pre-built UI kit and UI components that help in building and shipping apps to the market in the shortest possible time, instead of building everything from the ground up. These UI kits suited for testing tools, building MVP for funding, or in-app plugins to our existing app. It's less time-consuming, economical, and we just need to focus on the core business. Use video call kit and build features in no time with less complex coding. It offers various UI components with easy integration and flexible enough to handle most of the requirement. The UI kits covers the need of various industry and offers features like one-on-one calls, group calls, video conferencing, live streaming, live audio room, in-app chat. And here are some of the pre-built UI kits which you can explore, and you can see that how fast you can build feature-rich apps with less coding. You can start building your apps by simply signing up to the Zego Cloud, and you can get 10,000 minutes free. So you can just click on the start building, and then you can just do a sign up. And once you sign up, you will see this console. So you just need to click on create your project. You need to select which feature you want to build in your application, and then you give your project name and you will get all the configuration related to the project. You will also find a lot of tutorials how to build the features, like how to make WebRTC video call app, how to use iOS call kit for video call, and you can sort it based on the language. So if you need for JavaScript, you can just select JavaScript and you will find all the tutorials related to the JavaScript. So I highly recommend to use the UI kits and give a try to build the features in your application. Alright guys, so in this video, we are going to understand about monolithic architecture and how monolithic applications are built in Node.js. So in Node.js, a monolithic application is usually refers to an application that is built a single large code base, and typically it uses a single process or a thread. In monolithic application, all the components of the application are very tightly coupled and they run with a single process. And this makes it difficult to scale and modify individual components independently. Let's understand this with the help of a diagram. So we will see that we have a monolithic architecture based application, and this application is being used by the users. So users connect with this application as this application offers some services like customer service, product service, cart service. And all these services are very tightly coupled, as a customer service will always call the order service to get the orders of a particular customer, or a cart service to check the cart of a customer. And all these services is connected to a single database. So now let's see how these monolithic applications are deployed. So in a monolithic application, the entire code base is typically deployed as a single unit, and it just makes very easy to deploy and manage. But as the application grows, it becomes increasingly difficult to maintain and scale. And this is because that all the components of the application are closely integrated, and any changes or updates can affect the entire application. Let's understand this with the help of a diagram. This was our application, and now we want to deploy this application. So whenever we want to deploy this whole application, we need to make some artifacts. So let's create a zip file of it. Now we need to deploy this zip file into the server. So we see that we have the zip files, and now we will deploy it on different multiple servers. So this way, the whole application code base is deployed as a single unit. But this monolithic architecture comes with some pros and cons. Let's take a look at the advantages first. So the first advantage is simplicity. And monolithic applications are simple to develop, test, and deploy as they build as a single unit. And this makes it easy to manage and maintain the application. The second benefit is the cost effective. Since monolithic applications are built as a single unit, there is a less need of complicated architecture, and it is easier to deploy and maintain, making it cost effective. And the third one is the easier debugging. With monolithic applications, it is easy to track down the bugs since all the components are in one place, and making it easier to debug. But with these advantages, there are also a few challenges while using monolithic architecture. So let's take a look on that. The first one is the limited scalability, as monolithic applications can be difficult to scale since all the components are very tightly coupled, and make it challenging to scale individual components separately. The second is single point of failure. Since monolithic applications are deployed as a single unit, any failure in one component can affect the entire application, and making it as a single point of failure. There are some maintenance issues. As the application grows, it becomes increasingly challenging to maintain. Since all the components are tightly integrated, any changes to any of the component, we need to take down the entire application, and this makes it challenging to maintain. And the last one is the technology lock-in. Monolithic applications are typically built using a specific technology stack, making it difficult to switch to other technologies as the application grows. Now, with these advantages and disadvantages, there is a general rule of thumb that in which cases we can use the monolithic architecture to build applications. So we can make the monolithic applications are best suited for small and medium-sized projects with simple requirements where scalability is not a concern. However, for large and more complex projects that require scalability and flexibility, a microservices architecture is preferred. So the summary is that monolithic applications can be simpler to deploy and manage initially. They can become increasingly difficult to maintain and scale as the application grows. And to address these issues, many developers are now moving towards the microservices architecture. Alright guys, so in this video we are going to discuss about what microservices architecture is and how we build applications using microservices architecture in Node.js. So in Node.js, a microservices architecture is an approach to application development that involves breaking down a large complex application into smaller independent services. And those services can be developed, deployed, and scaled independently. Each of the microservices is responsible for a specific functionality of the application, and they communicate with each other through well-defined interfaces, usually using REST API or message queues. Let's understand this with the help of a diagram. So this was our application which we built using the monolithic architecture. Now we will see that how we can transform this application into a microservices architecture. So we are going to break down this complete application into smaller projects or into smaller microservices project. So let's see. So we have now three smaller projects. One is the user service, product service, and order service. And all these three are the microservices, and they have their individual database. So if we see about the user service, then this has a very specific functionality or the APIs which are related to the users. Similarly for the product, this microservices is only responsible for the product services. And then we have the order services. Now as these three are separate projects, their endpoints and the ports will also be differ. So the user will not communicate to these services directly. So for that, we are going to have a proxy or an API gateway, which is going to have a single endpoint with the port that can communicate internally with any of the services based on the user query. So the user will communicate with the API gateway, and in the background, we are going to have different services which will interact with each other. So in this way, all these three services can be built with different technology as they have their individual database and they have their specific functionality. So it's not dependent on a single technology stack. So in microservices architecture, each microservice can be developed and maintained by a separate team and can be deployed and scaled independently. This provides more flexibility and scalability compared to the monolith architecture, where all the components are tightly integrated, and any changes or updates to any of the component, we need to bring down the entire application. Now let's see how we deploy this. So we have three different microservices here. In order to deploy them, we are going to deploy them individually. So we have different pipelines for each of the project. So we are going to create the artifact or a zip first. All right, so now we have three different zips: user zip, product zip, and order zip, and all these three are independent of each other. So if we want to deploy them, we are going to deploy them in the server with three different pipeline, or we can also have a single pipeline which will have all the three. So it's really depend upon our use case. Next, let's see that if we have any changes in our user service, then how we can deploy this. So you will see that these are three microservices, and now we have some changes in the user service. So we are going to update some changes, and then we are only going to create a zip for the user service. Since product service and the order service doesn't have any changes, we don't need to deploy them, and they will work as independently. So we have created the new user zip, and then we are going to ship that user zip to our servers. So this really helps us with the flexibility. You don't need to bring down the entire application, and it's not a single point of failure. But with this microservices architecture, we do have some pros and cons. Let's take on the advantages first. So the first advantage is scalability. Microservices can be deployed and scaled independently, and this makes it easier to handle high traffic and spikes in demand. Second one is the flexibility. So each microservices can be developed and maintained independently, allowing for more flexibility and agility in the development process. Next is the fault tolerance. Since each microservices is developed independently, if failure in one service does not necessarily affect the entire application, and making it more fault tolerant. And the last one is the technology independence. Each microservice can be developed using different technology stack, allowing for more flexibility in choosing the best tool for the job. Now let's discuss some of the challenges that we face while building the microservices application. So the first one is the complexity. Managing multiple services can be complex sometimes than managing a single monolith application. Testing can be more complex in microservices architecture, as multiple services need to be tested independently and as a whole. And the last one is the deployment. So deploying multiple services can be more complex than deploying a single monolith application. So in a summary, microservices architecture in Node.js is a powerful approach to application development that can provide greater scalability, flexibility, and fault tolerance compared to the monolith architecture. However, it also introduces some additional complexity and challenges that needs to be addressed to ensure a successful implementation. Alright guys, so now we already know what the microservices architecture is and how we implement the microservices. Now the other question is how these microservices will communicate with each other. So let's say that if a customer service wants to have a communication with the order service in order to know the order of a customer, then how they are going to communicate. So in Node.js, there are several ways to implement communication between microservices, depending on your specific requirement and the architecture. So here are some of the most popular that we are going to discuss. And the first one is the HTTP REST API. So this is a synchronous way of communication where each service will wait for a response from the other service. And each service exposes its functionality as a set of RESTful endpoints that can be accessed by other microservices using HTTP request. Let's understand that with the help of a diagram. So here you will see that we have four different microservices: customer service, product service, cart service, order service. Now all these services are exposed with a REST API endpoints. So you will have the customer/customer ID. So customer is the entity. For the orders, you have the order as entity, products, and carts, where you can build your REST endpoints. So now if a customer service wants to access the orders, then it will send a HTTP call with a REST client. So we will have an HTTP request. Now the order service is going to respond an HTTP response to the customer service. And in this way, they can communicate with each other. Similarly, if a product service wants to communicate with the cart service, then they can send the HTTP request response. Now in Node.js, there are a couple of HTTP clients that we can use. The first one is the Axios. The second one is the Fetch. Then we can also use the Got package. We can use the Super Agent, and we can use the KY. So these are some of the popular HTTP client libraries that you can use in order to use the HTTP REST API communication between microservices. The second popular choice is the message queues. So message queues are a good option for asynchronous communication between microservices. Each microservice can publish a message to a queue, and the other microservices can consume those messages from the same queue. So you will see here that we have four services, the same four services. And in this case, we are going to have a message broker in between them. So they are not going to communicate directly, but they are going to communicate via a message broker. And the message broker is going to have some message queues inside that. So in this case, you will see that a customer wants to access the carts. So customer service will communicate with the cart service. So the customer service will be a publisher, and the cart service will be a subscriber. And the customer service is going to publish a message to a message queue. And then this message will be consumed by the subscriber. So you will see that the cart service is a subscriber and it's consuming the same message via messaging queues. So there are some popular message brokers which we can use. And those are the RabbitMQ, Kafka, AWS SQS. Third popular way of communication is the remote procedure call, and it is developed by Google, so it says gRPC. gRPC is a high performance RPC framework that uses buffer protocols for serialization and supports multiple programming languages, including Node.js. With gRPC, you can define services and messages using buffer protocol and generate client and server code for communication between microservices. The best part of this gRPC is that it's using HTTP2 protocol in order to transfer the data. And it is 5 to 7 times faster than using the normal REST API calls with HTTP. Let's understand how this gRPC call works. So you will see that we have two services. We have the customer service, we have the order service. And then we are going to implement a gRPC client and a server. So you will see that we have a gRPC client, which is a customer service who wants data from the order service, which is the gRPC server. Now in this client and the server, there is a communication via HTTP2, and this happens at a transport layer in the form of a protocol buffer. So the data will be sent in the form of a binary. So that's why it is more faster than the normal REST API calls. So let's understand that how this communication happens from a client to server. So whenever a client is implemented, it generates a client stub and have a gRPC runtime and the transport layer protocol we have. So the gRPC client is going to decode, encode, and have a client stub, which is then passed to the gRPC runtime. Then it passes that information or the messages to the transport layer. And then it forms in the form of a protocol buffer. It then passes with the help of an HTTP2 protocol to the order service, which again comes to the transport layer. Then it comes to the gRPC runtime and we get it to the gRPC server. Now the server in return will respond and can generate the encoding, decoding, and then give the response back in the same flow. So you will see that we have the response back from the server to the client. So this is how the communication happens with the help of gRPC between the microservices. Now in summary, when choosing a communication method for your microservices, it is very important to consider factors like performance, scalability, reliability, and the ease of implementation.